How do we prepare for the supernatural realm, which is the way, intermediate step to freeing ourselves from all determinacy whatsoever? How do we prepare? It's very simple. Sitting, the practice is to sit, just sit quietly. Either hear what's being said, hear what's being said, or just be fully present with how you feel right now, without anything being added or subtracted, okay? Without any motion, any expression whatsoever. Now, in a video, you're listening to someone transmission, but full stop in the now with your mind. You're not going imagining ahead, behind. You're not imagining processes at all. You just say, how do I feel right now? And just stay right in the moment. Stay right in the moment of how you feel right now. So you're not moving from the spot that you're at. Now, you're not trying to turn yourself into a stone. I mean, I'm moving my hands and, you know, like this. But if you're listening, you're staying in one spot. You're just sitting in one spot without moving your body, not springing into dance action. And also, you are just drinking water, okay? If you want something, you just have a sip of water. That's it. To put it in broader terms, sort of in a fasting mode while you're doing this. Now, how do you prepare to remain within a world of nature, this mirage of nature? Well, singing, dancing, and feasting is how you do that. Singing, dancing, and feasting keep you in the realm, in this mirage of determinacy, time, space, process, and form, belief in that. And how to go to the world of supernature, which helps free you from the delusion of determinacy, is sitting quietly, your mind full stop in the now, quiet, still, and you're fasting, as it were, minimizing, the opposite of feasting, let's put it that way. So on September 29th, I started dieting. It's a very tough time, isn't it? Because I said, you know what, it's time to go cold turkey. It's time to get into the right habits, including dropping off the feasting thing, because I was eating too much and feasting, and you just feel so much stress, you want to feast. So now it's very simple. Very simple food. Not trying to starve myself, but just a little oatmeal in the morning with some bananas and walnuts and some milk. A bowl of fruit in the for lunch. And evening, maybe some salad with, I found the shirataki noodles that have like 10 calories for a whole big serving. A little of that, and maybe some vegetables, and that's it. That's it. Nothing else. Drinking water. So it's time to get into the mode of deciding, where are you going to go? Where are you going to go? Are you going to continue on with this mirage of nature or the our supernature? Supernature is the intermediate step towards dropping the continuity fear altogether and realizing that spirit isn't, reality is entirely indeterminate. That what we call manifestation is not taking desire on the astral level and crystallizing it onto the material plane here through geometry and all mixing elements and all this stuff. That has nothing to do with reality. That has to do with the mirage. In reality, everything is instantaneous. Everything is just an appearance. There's no crystallization. There's no congealing. There isn't even here, but there's the illusion of that. Everything's self-sprung, spontaneously self-sprung in the now. It just arises. The desire and the arising is simultaneous, coincident, concurrent. It's concurrent. Okay. Reality is all totally concurrent. There's no such thing as layers and levels and time and space and all that. It's all totally concurrent now. And it's a complete abstraction based on what we're used to, because we try to create differently than reality, separate reality, through determinancy, through process, through form, all this. This so-called cosmos of manifestation is a dream. It's spirit trying to create differently than God creates. All right, separate reality. So we don't need to know anything about this dream in terms of what to do about it. That's just a dream. We don't just stop dreaming, just set it down. Because this whole dream itself is completely indeterminate. That's what scares us. We want to say, no, I need... So the intermediate step, supernature, it still is appearance of determinancy, forms, appearance. But you begin to realize there's no process at all taking place there. See, it's just the bare bones, just the bare bones of appearance there, a stable appearance. Okay, the appearance is stable. There's nothing that says in reality we cannot have an appearance keep arising every moment exactly as it was before. We can certainly do that. Absolutely. But the next instant it can unmanifest and we can be on to something else. We're not attached to any valuing of any appearance. We simply are playing like children, enjoying, and then we're on to the next play, and like that, it's like that. Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is like the play of little children, as a metaphor. So, you know, they're imagining, and then they drop their imagining, go into something else, and they're not crying about their imagining suddenly is gone, you know, like that. So, it's like that. That's a simile or whatever, a metaphor for the kingdom of heaven, a reality. So in supernature, it's the bare bones, a beautiful appearance of everything's immaculate, but there's no process. You realize there's no process going on. There's no process sustaining the appearance. It's spirit. It's our spirit is sustaining the appearance just through desire. Directly. We're not trying to fool ourselves. It's just a direct appearance directly from the desire to have this intermediate step. So we'll look and we'll see, oh, this looks like a beautiful park. Parkland. Wow, this is beautiful. Where's the golf course? You know, we're thinking, wow, where must be a golf course around here somewhere so beautiful. And then you begin to gradually realize there's no process taking place. There's no feasting taking place. There's no dance taking place. There's no, you know, there's no singing taking place, so to speak. There's no, need. There's no need whatsoever there. It's just one solid block of appearance. And then this is so it gradually starts seeping into you. And if you have not prepared, that's when you start freaking out. So to take a pagan, a heathen who's into dancing and singing and feasting to a supernatural world, at first they'll say, wow, this is great. We should have a party here. You know, I feel like singing and dancing. And then they say, ah, well, something's different here. You know, it's just, you know, where's the processes of nature that to celebrate? You know, where are the elements? Where's the, and then it's like, whoa, you know, it's like, what is this? Ah, freak out. Where are the cycles of nature? Where's the life and death? Where's all these things that the pagan celebrate? You know, the celebration of the cycles of nature. Paganism is nature worship. Let's be plain and simple. Jesus told us that we need to abide in supernature, not be nature worshipers. You have to drop the nature worshiping with all its festivals. All its festivals, okay? in this, what's happening in this world is all these pagan festivals are coming back. Even to the point of insisting that Christmas is now just, you know, pretty a pagan festival, which it was previously, wasn't it? Yeah, what Christianity does, what did was took over the pagan festivals and try and help the pagans try to calm down and start orienting towards supernature, which was entirely appropriate. You have to start somewhere. You see, it's phase one. You have to get into phase one somewhere. But the pagans, you know, they had all these festivals of nature worship. And Christianity said, look, you need to start transferring your allegiance over to supernature. It's very simple. It's not complex. But now all of that is coming back, and the pagan nature worshiping is the new world religion. Okay. So that's why I say it's the end of the church age. When you can't even say Christmas anymore, you know it's the end of the church age. That's a pretty good sign, right? That the pagans have reclaimed their festivals of singing, drinking, and singing, dancing, feasting. You know, luxuriating in the bounty of nature. In other words, you know, just seizing it and trying to, you know, feel, I feel so happy here. This is where I want to stay forever. This is our home, you know, all this stuff. Thank you, worship, thank you for giving us a home. Can you imagine spirit saying to this place, oh, thank you for giving me a home? That is really funny. Spirit, the absolute sovereign, total sovereign. Spirit is the extension of God, the complete sovereign. Spirit is God in God's attribute of extension of God, expansion, extension of God, total sovereign, primary sovereign, you see, extension of the prime creator. And spirit's supposed to be saying to this garbage dump, oh, thank you for giving me a home, garbage dump, I'm so grateful. You have to keep your sense of humor about this, because it truly is hilarious. And yet that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. You have to stop being so serious and have to be able to laugh about it. It's very, very funny. In spite of our fear, we have to laugh through our fear here. So, in supernature, what you feel like, what happens is it brings this intrinsic stillness to you. Like you just feel like sitting there, sitting quietly, like on a bench in some beautiful park, and just, you know, just sitting there. And and it feels like something is sort of saturating you. You feel like you're saturated with, and you just want to sit there. And you say, what is this I'm being saturated with? What is this? Wow. Okay, now if you've practiced here in this world, in the world of nature, see, the thing is the continuity fear, we can't just, you know, snap our fingers and leap from nature to supernature without any practicing here as we dwell in this world of nature. The whole purpose of religion is to say, look, folks, this is a mirage, a desire to be separate from God. You cannot be separate from God. You have to accept the fact that you are what you are, which is spirit. So you have to stop dreaming eventually. You have no choice. So what do you do? Well, you have to begin discipline. You have to begin discipline here in this world. You cannot simply continue to run riot as a child of nature, Mother Nature's son and daughter. You cannot. You have to begin to discipline, so you switch from a pagan mindset over to a religious mindset, whatever your religion happens to be. The bottom line is discipline. Okay, you have to discipline. The singing and the dancing and the feasting need to, you know, put on the back burner. You have to spend times meditating, prayer, quiet times, and you have to, you know, begin the spiritual path. There's no exception to that. So in doing that, you gradually get more and more used to abstraction, more and more used to abstraction, even while we're here in this world. So that when you go to supernatural realm, and this, you begin to feel this saturation, this permeation that's everywhere. Everywhere. Wherever you go, it's the same. It's like, wow. You're able to just sit quietly. You're able to keep the discipline going that you already have. Habits of attention. Habits of awareness transcend any appearance, and so you keep those habits going. And then you're able to begin to realize, wow, there's no process here. There's no nature here. You begin to see the absence of nature, even though there's an appearance of nature. You begin to experience the absence of what we call nature, which is, and so the key is, you don't freak out because of your religious discipline that you have undergone. You can handle it. You say, okay, this is what I prepared for. I have the right habits of attention. I know I have to get used to, now it's a situation of getting used to the absence of nature. It's that simple. Within continuity, because all the forms are still there. Let's say you see a picture. You're looking at a picture. All the forms are, oh, look at these beautiful, all the forms are there. But there's no process taking place, right? Well, in the supernatural realm, everything is there. But there's none of the processes of nature, the biological, chemical, none of those processes, physics, none of those things are, none of that is taking place. You still have the semblance of gravity, so to speak, even though you probably could float anywhere you want to. But it's all an appearance. It's a dream within a dream. Nature is a dream. Supernature is a kind of restorative dream, a dream of the absence of nature. You might put it this way. You're dreaming of the absence of nature, but still having the appearance. And then once you get used to the absence of nature, then you realize this is all appearance and you're not scared at all. So, oh, this is fine. I can play with this appearance, you know. And then you start functioning once again as you were created to function. Is just this play, this tremendous play. But realizing it's totally indeterminate. There's no such thing as anything bound at all. It's what we call nature, is the whole idea of being bound. Conditions. There are no conditions in reality. Nothing is bound. There's no bondage at all in reality. There's no being bound to circumstances, being bound to situations. None of that whatsoever. It's completely indeterminate. In other words, it's whatever you desire this very moment, and then nothing more than that. And this moment does not determine the next moment at all. When we say reality is totally indeterminate, we mean this moment does not determine the next moment in the slightest bit, and the previous moment did not determine this moment in the slightest bit. Even though you may keep the same appearance there, it is not caused by this moment. It is spontaneously arising in the now of each now, the continual matrix of now, the pure, omnipresent matrix of now. You say, oh, okay, well, I like this appearance. I want to keep playing with this appearance. So the next moment, it's seamlessly arising concurrently with your desire, instantly, concurrently. So you're able to play with it. But one moment does not determine the next at all. Not in the slightest bit as far as a determinancy between appearances, you see. Desire is not bound by the appearances that arise at all. Or desire to experience is not. So reality is totally indeterminate. This is the facts. These are the facts. And so there is no such thing as nature. It doesn't exist. Even this nature, just a mirage, it doesn't really exist. It's not really determinate, even though it appears to be. It's a very grand illusion, as they say. So it's such a grand illusion that we're kind of scared to let go of it, thinking maybe I'm letting go of some determinancy that's like, you know, like the illusion is all important. We have to have that, or else how can we function? That's what we think. So we need this phase of going, of experiencing the absence of nature. Of course, in reality, you don't experience a negative like that, an absence of something. It's not like that. But from a standpoint of continuity, we do, I believe, have this important intermediate step where we can experience, there's the appearance of nature, but nature is absent. How nice, how great, wow. That's a really big wow. It's the biggest wow of all, actually. So it's not the beauty that we need to get used to. So this is very important. It's not like we can throw festivals of singing and dancing and feasting and beautiful spots in this world and that gets us ready for super nature. It doesn't. Although we think it might, because, oh, look how beautiful it is here. Now, it's not the beauty, so to speak. All right. It's the absence of nature. That's the key. And there isn't any place in this world where there's an absence of nature. Okay. At least the illusion of nature. There isn't anywhere. It's like that. I will say that what a lot of the great meditators seem to be in places where they looked out over vast expanses of sky. Now Longchenpa talks about reality being skylight. So his cave looked out upon the vastness of sky with mountain ranges, but really he was like up there in a mountain, and you see there's no trees, there's very little nature there actually, where a lot of these yogis are in places where there's very little nature. There's like a rock cave and they're looking out on the sky, and that's where Longchenpa was. And sky seems to be devoid of nature, doesn't it? So as you simply contemplate the sky or be surrounded by sky all the time, it does seem that might make it easier. I'm just saying that's a possibility. Just stone, nothing growing, just sky and stone. That might free you from a lot of the influence of nature. That's possible. But practically speaking, there is no place on this planet that is devoid of nature at all, is there? The sky actually is full of nature, but it seems less so, doesn't it? But there's actually air currents, pressure. It's all pressure gradients and air currents and change, constantly changing. And but he always talks about the sky and the clouds and how they just seem to appear and then disappear and stuff like that. And so that can give some, you know, faint echo perhaps. But really, in the supernatural realm, there is no nature at all. Even though the appearance of nature is there. So obviously, it's misleading to talk about how beauty, natural beauty, thinking that prepares you for supernature. It does not. See, the pagans love natural beauty, and they like to go there and feast and dance and sing and just rejoice in the beauty of this nature world. But the thing is to think that they can be pulled into supernature merely by telling them, hey, you know what, it's really beautiful there. Waterfalls, trees, or it's a great park, you'll love it. It is totally misleading. Totally misleading. Because they're not prepared at all for the absence of nature. They'll say, yeah, it's beautiful, but I'm feeling like completely jittery here. I don't feel comfortable at all. I feel like very frightened. So you cannot do it that way. You cannot appeal to the pagans' love of nature to get them into supernature. And even singing and all that stuff, it is a way of moving processes and moving and shaping and forming and all this. It's an expression of nature. It's nature worship, praising itself, so to speak. There's no nature in supernature. So if you're totally addicted to needing to appraise nature, you'll feel like, wow, how can I express? I can't express this. I can't, right? So you have to practice non-expression, abstraction, non-expression. Be still, be quiet. Because what you do is you appreciate it without any need for expression. Without any need for reaction. See, it's direct experiencing appreciation without any need to crystallize some reaction. Try to react as if that's creativity. Reaction is not creativity, as Jesus pointed out. He said the creativity that we're used to in this world is not creativity. It is not. It is part of illusion, very strong part of it. I mean, singing, dancing, create all the creativity we do here. He said, no, that is not creativity. Those are reactions to images, which is a belief in crystallization, which is a belief in nature, which is a belief in separation from God, all this. So it's that's why being still and quiet and non-expressive is so important in your practice. Think about praising the nature. We're saying how beautiful it is here. How beautiful is my home. How wonderful is all this crystal, apparent crystallization and congealing and frozen light. How happy I am to be here. I don't want to go anywhere else. This is wonderful. You know, it's nature, this the delusion of nature worshiping itself. Self-idolatry. It's idolatry, actually. Spirit idolizing itself. This is really, nature just an expression of our continuity fear. It is an expression of our continuity fear. So we have to stop the worshiping of nature. Now, there might be places where you feel nature is like more suspended. Okay, it doesn't seem to be so prevalent. Okay, still, you need to be quiet. You need to sit still, quiet, mindful, stop in the now. No feasting, no dancing, no singing, no merrymaking. And just practice being permeated, saturated, saturation. Some throughout history have gone out to the desert, gone out to something. Said the desert doesn't seem like any nature's taking place hardly at all. They're just there. Live in a cave in the desert somewhere. And you become very used to. A lot of the religions sprung up from desert people who don't live in the lush, flesh pot nature areas of the world, you know, where it's arid, it's dry, there's no nature, live in caves, and they're able to evaporate the continuity fear. They sit quietly, they meditate, they still, and they get used to the absence of nature, trying to get used to it more and more and more, at least the apparent absence. And this helps them accept supernature. And so they're able then to tell everybody, hey, there's this supernature. It's way better than nature. It's the absence of nature. And bring that message to the world. However, when they go from the desert into the fleshpot areas, you know, of the pagans, you know, bountiful rivers and trees and fruits and food and wine and merrymaking and all this, you know, they go into them and tell them, hey, you know, they say, well, what are you talking about? You know, come on in and have some food. enjoy, right? And so it doesn't translate well. I love the desert. It feels like there's absolutely nothing taking place. As far as nature goes, nothing. And then the fact that there's also some nature there, it's like, yeah, there's nothing taking place, and yet there's still an appearance of nature, that kind of thing, like a palm tree in the desert. It's like, there's really nothing taking place here, nature-wise, and yet here's this tree or something. It gives you that interesting juxtaposition. So religions don't really translate that well from one place to another because, like I said, if you're in an area where just the nature is just intense, you know, animals everywhere, just rotting, decaying, growing, just, you know, it's just intense moisture, just a nature environment, it permeates you, nature, and it's trying to explain to them that there's no such absence of nature, that, you know, this, like, they'll just put it in the context of what they're permeated with. They say, yeah, what kind of festival do you have? Nature festival do you have? what are you talking about? A new type of festival? Okay, great. What are we eating? What kind of dance is there? And give us the songs. And let's put all the flowers and, you know, how do we celebrate nature? You have a new way to celebrate nature? And then they say, well, actually, no, we're celebrating the absence of nature. And it's like, what? You're crazy. Yeah. It's like that. So there's an answer. Why do these yogis go up into the spiritual renunciates, go up into the mountains and sit in caves? You know, they're just like, there's no nature there at all, almost. You just think they're crazy. Why they're missing out on all the beauties of the valley and the nature and festivities and beautiful clothing and the festivals and festive nature worshippers who are very colorful and full of lively animal spirits and lots of libations are flowing, great food, you know, wonderful party atmosphere, and people are just enjoying their lives, and here's this ascetic up in a cave and high in the mountains where there's no trees, no nothing, just barren. They must be completely nuts, we think. But now we're seeing they're not nuts at all. Super smart. But it's good for us to at least understand what is it, what's the aim of that? Practicing the absence of nature. Which means the absence of the belief in determinacy, which means restoring them to the acceptance of that reality is totally indeterminate, which then gives them everything right now. You see, because reality is totally indeterminate, all is all right now. All is all right now. So all glory is right now. In the perfect absence of all determinacy, all glory is omnipresent right now. And whatever you desire, it's like a feast, that endless feast. You can feast on anything, always. Everything is omnipresent, so to speak. You can experience it, the feast of experiencing, like that. So we have tried to create a separate creation and then trying to make ourselves happy here. So we're feasting on food, you know, gnawing on a drumstick or something and pouring some wine down and laughing and having some entertainment, some entertainers, you know, the whole Roman Empire thing, Babylon, United States today, the world, you know, bread and circuses. And we're saying, wow, we're happy, we're feasting on everything. No, we're not. No, we're not. This is not what God created us as. All glory is omnipresent. Because there's this perfect indeterminacy. The ground of being is this perfect indeterminacy. Absolutely perfect. And so we're never bound to anything whatsoever. Therefore, all is ours. Whatever we want. We're not completely unbounded. This is our nature. This is what we are. This is our identity. This is our functionality. So we have really tried to bind ourselves. And the fact is we can't, actually. Bodies help us believe that we can, but we cannot. So we got no choice but to go through this spiritual path. Discipline. There's a discipline. The ascetics up there are undergoing discipline to get back to glory. They're not saying this barren mountain is an end in itself. Not at all. It is simply an expedient and an intelligent means to reawaken and accept that all glory is omnipresent for all. All glory is omnipresent for all. This is a fact. And then, of course, the realization of that, then they're beyond any notion of determinacy whatsoever. They realize they're spirit, you see. So putting yourself in a situation that's helpful is an expedient. It's not an end in itself. So the pagans will say, wow, they're crazy disciplined, crazy knucklehead religious people, avoiding all this wonderful merrymaking that we're, you know, constantly engaged in. Wow, you know, what's the matter with them? They're missing out on the pleasures of life, pleasures of nature, the riches of nature. They're missing out on it. What, missing out on imprisonment? I mean, they're getting free of this horrible prison is what they're doing. Because you can only feel happy in a prison so long, and eventually all the merrymaking. Imagine you're in prison cell, and you're just constantly feasting and dancing and singing. Ah, this is great. I just love it in here. But eventually, you know, you just say, wow, I'm getting sick, I'm getting old, I'm tired, I'm sick. What is this place, you know, really? So you can only put on appearances for so long, but this pretense doesn't last forever. This pretense of being happy here doesn't last forever. It's just a pretense based on fear, continuity fear. We're pretending that we're so happy here. In this illusory prison of determinancy, of, you know, fake determinancy. An illusion of determinancy is what it is. It's a grand illusion of determinancy. But we're miserable here, absolutely miserable, but we're terrified of indeterminacy, pure indeterminacy, because we think, wow, there's too much glory, this omnipresent glory for all. Omnipresent glory for all. Too good for me. That's the continuity fear. So we have to work on this. Bring to mind intermediate step of supernature. Now some, I believe, It may be possible that some of the great meditators can experience supernature. Their body is just simply inert, and their spirit is experiencing supernature. And actually, what they can do is their body just, they put their body into sort of a suspended animation, and their spirit appears in the realm of supernature, and is enjoying supernature, even while the physical body is sitting in a cave somewhere. And then they come back and they can awaken the body and move the body around and get a little, some berries, whatever, for it. And some of them don't even need to eat, actually. They can put the body there in like suspended animation. These are things that have been known throughout history. But so I don't know exactly what is going to happen. It is whether we will shift into supernature. You know, is that what's going to happen? Are we going to put the body in suspended animation and experience supernature? Are we going to continue preparing for supernature? These are the three basic options, I would say. Either we simply keep preparing for supernature, and then the body dies eventually, and then we go to supernature then and stay there, or do we learn to put the body in suspended animation and appear in supernature and experience that absence of nature, which is what supernature really is? Or is there some sort of translation of the body where the body turns into a body of light, or somehow it's shifted into appearing in supernature, and the body that leaves this world of nature no longer appears here, but that doesn't die, doesn't need to die. You can go to supernature that way. These are like three basic options, I would say. So, option one is we keep practicing. That's always always necessary. Is option one, we have to always keep practicing as long as we are here. Option two is possible in some way. It could be possible. Suspended animation, the body's still in this world of nature as an appearance, but it's hardly moving at all. Now, there's even a higher option, but I think that's off the plate for most of us, really, is to be functioning in this world mostly, you know, all the time, and yet being in this supernatural awareness all the time. Those are the great saviors, like Sri Ananda Mahimas, like that. Now, that this is, you know, beyond, I think, what any of us should consider, because by her own admission, her appearance was not the result of any previous birth or karma or whatsoever. So there's zero difficulty, no need for any training for trying to shed, you know, continuity fear. None, zero. We have severe continuity fear, so we cannot even think in that terms. It's not appropriate. So we have to, option one is practice. Option two is perhaps there will be some time where suspended animation is possible. Option three is some sort of transformation and shift is also possible. Very much so. The same as what Jesus is talking about, coming back and taking those to his dwelling place, which is a supernatural place, from this world, bodily. You know, the rapture is those actually bodies being I think they said that the bodies will be caught up and transformed into bodies of light and taken to the higher heavens or something, supernatural realm. That's also a possibility. But one way or the other, we have to ultimately make our way to supernature, the supernatural realm, which is devoid of nature, absence of nature there, and get used to it. Everybody has to do that. So the know-how as to how to do that is very important. When a world is abandoned to paganism, it's a lost world. It's a dark world. Because the know-how is lost, you see. and has to be reintroduced at some point. Perhaps the best time is after the pagans have just so engorged out and just they're so hungover, you know, just say, wow. They've so much indulged in nature worship that they just are sick of it. Just say, I just can't do this anymore. Keep in mind that all those who have gone on to be saints, meaning they're dwelling in supernature. Somehow the absence of nature is something that they're now radiating. They were pagans at one time, like St. Clement of Alexandria, one of the doctors of the church. St. Francis was a severe pagan. You know, they were all pagans, basically, at some point. A lot of them grew up in pagan homes, most of them. And they said, wow, you know, this isn't it. Nature worship isn't it. St. Clement of Alexandria was one of the great critiquers of paganism and saying how it's wrong. This is not the way that Christianity, what Jesus came to tell us is the right way. And he showed how, you know, the goddess worshiping, the fertility worshiping, the worshiping of food and things and fruit and idols and deifying forces of nature and all this stuff. He says, this is delusion. Okay, this is not the way. Not the way. And this is the essence of religion and Christianity, is saying nature worship is not the way. This is essentially what it is. And that supernature is the way. And you must prepare for supernature. You cannot just go directly from being a nature worshiper to supernature without moving your comfort zone in that direction. But the moving of the comfort zone has to have some discipline to it. You cannot be totally undisciplined. You have to move briskly. This is what Sri Sri Anandamayi would say, who was a great exponent of moving away from nature worship. Even though she hung out among nature worshipers, what she was doing was trying to say, hey, you know, you gotta move away from that. But did it in a way of simply her presence. See, this is why we cannot really use her as an example as far as certain ways, because it was a sheer presence of her that, of this appearance, that caused people to say, hey, wait a minute, there's something better than nature. So she would be at these festivals, Durga festivals, all these festivals of nature worshiping and stuff, Kali festivals, and they'd say, oh, you're Durga, you know, you're the goddess of nature, thank you for coming, please pray for we have good, nice children and happy lives and everything like that. And she said most people came for that. And they wanted songs, they wanted food, you know, and stuff. And so she went along with that, you know, which I found very odd, you know. But in this unique case, just one moment. Okay, but in this unique case, and she said, don't use my appearance as an example for others, she said. She says, very important, no, this is a very unique case. It was a sheer presence of supernature. It's like an incarnation of supernature. That even when they were celebrating all these, you know, goddess worshiping celebrations, nature worshiping celebrations, they kind of would feel like, hey, you know, it seems like there's something better. You know, can you? And then they'd say, can you give us some? Is there some way to get what is it you have? Can you help us with this? It seems to be better, you know. and they couldn't bind her. She kept leaving. They said, no, we prayed for you to stay, and you leave us. And wow. So it was the sheer presence of that which sort of transformed their attitudes. But that's a very unique sort of case, actually. So we cannot use that as, that's what we should do. We should hang out with nature worshipers. No. That is not what we should do. We are not the same case. It's not the same case. This was a unique, very unique case. Because this was a perfect obliviousness to nature, so to speak. to what the, you know, total, with effortless, oblivious, just complete super nature there, just in all ways, at all times, there was a continuity, perfect continuity to it, and that's what gradually started shaking people up, was the seamlessness of it, you know. That's the whole thing, and for us, we might be able to try to do that for a little while, but we cannot be that utterly, totally perfect seamlessness of it. No, there's no way, and not yet, you know, that's way down the road for us. So we should not be hanging out with pagans, because when we try to pull pagans out of nature worship, what happens is they pull you in. They pull you in, is what happens. Because their fear of the absence of nature is so extreme, and yours is quite severe anyway, even though we're trying. It's easy for them to pull you in. I mean, it's super difficult to pull them out, because you yourself are very frightened. So they can just easily pull you right back into nature worship. Easy. So she said, spend all your time in holy pursuits around holy people. Stay away from all those festivities and merrymaking, and be disciplined in your life. Do more spiritual practice. Her rules and her ashrams are very, very strict, exceedingly strict. Total celibacy, no stimulants whatsoever. Much fasting, okay. Simple foods, simple dress, quiet. Her ashrams were a very different thing than these festivities that they asked her to show up at. They were super, super, super strict. Very demanding. So this is an instance of someone whose appearance was able to permeate the pagan society and sort of uplift the whole situation. This is not something that we should try, okay? No. This is not something we should try at all. We should stay away from pagan society, absolutely. Christians, for example, Christianity and all religions, they form communities that stay away from pagan society. I mean, the monasteries, the religious orders, the basic communicants are supposed to live very austere lives, not worshiping nature. And that shows up in the clothes that they wear, the body language, the food that they eat, you know, plain, simple food, plain, simple. What they drink water, for instance, just drink water. You're not celebrating nature. You're not here to celebrate nature. You're here to prepare for supernature. This is the religious path. But it's virtually impossible for us to completely drop it, as Jesus says, you know, just release it all. Because we do, even though this is an expression of our continuity fear, we're still manifesting all this. We manifested all of this. So we have some love for it, you know, the beautiful trees and flowers and stuff, yeah. So we're not called on to hate it. We're not called on to hate it. And indeed, in supernature, you still have the trees and the flowers and all that, okay? So God is not calling on you to hate your expression of your continuity fear, because you are manifesting. It is your creativity. It is our creativity. But we must realize, we must drop the valuing of it, as Jesus says. This is his central thing, central point. You must drop the valuing. The only way, he said, the only way to love is actually freedom. Love is perfect freedom. It is the only way to perfect freedom is to drop your valuing, is to drop all your valuing. So supernature helps us with that. We still have beautiful nature. Okay, we're not called, you know, you see a beautiful tree or a bush with flowers and you say, wow, that's very lovely, very lovely. At the same time, we're feeling this complete absence of nature. So we realize that the the indeterminacy of this, meaning it's nothing but an appearance. And being that it's nothing but an appearance, we gradually realize that we can have the same, exact same appearance forever if we want. There's no forces, there's no cycles of nature that we need. We don't need to wait, plant a seed and wait for a plant to grow, and then it starts getting old and dying. There's not all this change. You can have it any way you want this instant. All glory is omnipresent for all. So, yeah, you may, in our experience, we may imagine, desire to experience rivers of flowers. We can imagine anything at all. We can experience anything at all. We can, there can just be a whole world of all rivers or nothing but infinite varieties of flowers floating along. Don't even need any water, just a flow of flowers like that. We can imagine that. The problem is, and I tried to do that here, but there still seems to be a problem of trying to do that here. This is the difficult situation here. Should we be trying to actively imagine this now or not is the question. I still haven't resolved that. Because that can easily get into nature worship. Like how beautiful nature is, how awesome nature is. We need to keep nature going. See, that there's a... Okay, anyway, we won't struggle with it. We keep the narrative going. But that does have to be clarified in some way. Now, some like to sit and meditate by the banks of rivers because the flow of a river, it seems to be a flow of indeterminacy, doesn't it? Like in Haridwar, Ganges, many saints and sadhus are there meditating on just sitting by the river, and because the river is always, the water just seems to be indeterminate. It's very indeterminate. Maybe it reminds them of the truth of indeterminacy. But indeterminacy does not mean chaos. You see, this is very important. Indeterminacy is actually perfect order. Because exactly whatever you want, this exact moment is what you have. That's perfect order, isn't it? There's nothing changing what you want into something else, which would be going towards chaos. Chaos is the belief in determinacy that everything is completely out of your control. You're not experiencing anything you want. That's chaos. Indeterminacy means whatever you want to experience this moment is exactly what you're experiencing. So that's perfect order. So indeterminacy is really perfect order. It could be that, like the river of flowers thing, I was just revisiting that. It could be that you should not try to set up festivals of flowers and stuff in this world. That's pagan nature worship. You should do it within, in your imagination. Get used to that. Because in nature worship, you see all this determinacy, and you're saying, wow, look how apparent determinacy, look how beautiful we can make determinacy seem. Right? So we can have our cake and eat it too. We can live in this dream of determinacy and yet still have these float flowers on a river and like say, wow, this is great. This is, just the tiniest speck of a speck of a speck of a crumb of what we're truly capable of. We're not a body at all. We're spirit. So Jesus said that the glory of spirit, there's no way you can even explain it. He says even this universe, this entire universe, is only an infinitesimal speck of our creative expression. Infinitesimal speck, this whole universe. Okay. And he's looking at it from the standpoint of the glory of indeterminacy, right? scientists, they always say, because much of the universe is the same, isn't it? It's just quantity, you know. There's a billion galaxies, a billion trillions of planets and stars, you know. There's a few different types of, and you know, why, how is that an expression of our perfect glory, all glory to all omnipresent glory, you know, all omnipresent glory to all. It's not that big of an expression at all, actually. But he says, don't struggle with trying to figure out the glory, just prepare for it. So it is a huge question of skillful means. That is a question that I'm still struggling with. So just don't try not to struggle with it here. Because again, we do need to prepare for supernature, which is the absence of nature. And if we're not doing that, well, we will miss the boat. We will miss the boat. So if you're spending all your time with festivities and festivals of flowers and music and stuff, say, well, that's very indeterminate, you know. Yeah, but you're not really preparing for supernature. The total absence of nature, even though there's the appearance of appearances of natural, what we call forms. One moment, please. Okay, so what I've been tormented by is, I feel that people are not preparing, we're not preparing well at all. And so I feel I'm trying to develop skillful means that might help others. But in so doing, I find run into a lot of trouble, actually. If you start using music, if you start using, you know, nature, flowers and stuff, flower arrangements, and all that, easily you go into nature worship. It's a real... This is the conflict of my life is how do you help with skillful means of those who seem to need a boost, you know? But whatever I've tried doesn't work in terms of trying to meet pagans halfway. It doesn't click. They you know, they want nature worship. And they say, well, sitting still and listening to abstraction is too difficult. Right. Well, that's why I have phase one. Phase one is like the fundamental basic beginnings, where you have the churches or the places of worship, and you have the beautiful flowers there, and you have some song, and like Roman Catholicism is like a phase one. There's a beginning, beginners, for beginners. But you have to go to phase two, three, and four. So I cannot, you know, do all phases. I cannot be all things for everyone. It just doesn't work that way. I would say there are a lot of what I guess is it is that pagans think they're very smart. Okay, and the idea of like starting in phase one, like a Roman Catholic Church or any kind of church, to them is just like an anathema. This is something I've directly experienced in my life. It's just like, to them, that is utterly unthinkable. But so they say, oh, you can help us. We're beyond that, you know. No, they're not. They haven't even started. The thing about Roman Catholicism is it mixes paganism with Christianity, is what it does. And people might say, well, it's not pure. Well, if it was pure, none of the pagans would show up. No, nobody would show up in phase one. If you taught like phase four there, nobody would show up. So pagans have to start somewhere. And so what they have to do, what do you do in like in the mass of Roman Catholicism? Well, you go in there. You're supposed to be dressed down. No one's supposed to pay any attention to you. You're there for prayer and silence. You're not there for socializing, okay? So socializing is way down. How you dress is way down. Your body language in the church is very respectful. You're very quiet. You're supposed to be very quiet. You sit still in the pew. You listen to the teaching. And then there is music, which kind of says, oh, you know, we say, well, great, there's some music. This is getting boring, you know. So they mix, and they mix, and there's some flowers on the altar and the sides. There are the various shrines and of flowers. There's the, you know, the Mother Goddess, Virgin Mary is there. So people can feel at least like, well, you know, Mother Nature is not entirely absent here. They're at least acknowledging Mother Nature. Even though the real symbolization of Virgin Mary is supernature, actually. So the discipline necessary is there. It's just mixed in with paganism, so pagans don't freak out. The festivities are there, you know, the robes are there, and celebrating the cycles, you know, and the, you know, the Easter, the Christmas, the various celebrations are there, which have pagan overtones or undertones. And so it's a way to get started, actually. It's a way to get started. But what I've seen is that pagans say that's totally beneath them. Totally beneath them. But getting started is beneath them. How is that possible? So they tend to go into more like Buddhism. The pagans these days, you know, it's something, some was got full of intellectual stuff that, you know, they say, I don't need any actual practice at all. Like, you know, to go from, what do pagans do? Festivities, festivals, sporting events, bread and circuses. So you go with a group of people. But in Catholicism, you go to a group of people, they congregate to this place, and you have a toned down festival, way toned down. So you get used to toning it down, toning the festivities down. Okay, this is very important. But most pagans think, no, all I need to do is get some book, you know, and read about some religious teaching. And, oh, that's great, I got it, I think I understand what they're saying. And then go out and bread and circuses. I think that this is it, I've done what I need to do. I haven't even started. What has to happen is the toning down of festivities first. The sobering down of all this attitude of festivity. So you're there in the church, even though there's some music, it's all very, now stop this, very toned down, the singing is toned down. That's why we had this pagan, very pagan singer there, who sings like a pagan, just hooping and hollering and you know, real full-on over-gospelized, you know, kind of singing stuff. It's all emotional, and she forwarded it once, and as I said, someone said, wow, you have a beautiful voice, and it put her on the spot, like, wow, it's pagan. It's bringing paganity too much into the church. She was replaced with another woman who sings very humbly. Very, very humbly. No fireworks at all. Okay. This is called toning it down. Toning it down. So sure, the people in there have strong pagan sensibilities, but they're practicing toning it down. This is the first step. I call it phase one. Once you really have gone through phase one and you're really used to toning it all down, then you go into phase two, where you start to gain the context of this whole situation. Well, what are you really going towards? What's really, you re-examine the whole structure of your belief is phase two. It's a re-examination of your belief system is phase two, is what happens. You can't do that until you've toned your life down. You really have to tone your life down so it becomes a new life where you're sober, a sober life. You're not going to all these festivities. For instance, if someone would invite me to a World Series game, which might happen, you know, I'd say, well, you know, that's really great, but I think I'm not going to be able to go. Because it's a riotous atmosphere there, you know. What do? I tone it down. I watch some on television or something, a baseball game, and enjoy, laugh a little bit, but am I feasting? No, I'm having maybe some water, some grapes, and then I kind of go away for a little while. It's toned down, toned down, toned down, toned down, like that. So phase two is you begin to re-examine your belief system in a toned down, with toned down discipline in your life. Once you re-examine your belief system, you realize, wow, the pagan belief system is going totally crazy. No wonder why I needed to tone it down. You say, wow, and you realize, hey, I can get free of this. I'm seeing that there's a way to get free of this. Phase three is when you begin to accept new beliefs, a new belief system. Okay. Phase three, you really get into a new belief system and you really gravitate to a new belief system. And phase four is when you then accept the disciplines of that new belief system, which is the silent sitting, the truly silent sitting. You get really ready for supernature to be. You get phase four is essentially preparation, the last intense preparation for the absence of nature. So these basic phases have to be everywhere in the cosmos, and okay, because you either believe in nature or you don't. See, everyone who believes in nature has a need to divest themselves of that belief. There's no way around it. Now the pagans right now, their goal is to paganize all of religion to the point where it's not even phase one at all. And you're getting to that point right now, actually. It's moving that way very rapidly. They say, quote unquote, pagans say, oh, we have to have women in charge here. You know, in other words, they need to change, because they feel that through women they can pep it up, you know, make it more pagan. And so they go to church, it's like, hey, this is just like festival, you know, this is like Oktoberfest, and look at all the festivities here. And after church you can go and have beer and a feast after church, you know, and wow, this is great. And more music, and now let's get rid of those somber men, you know, disciplined, severe, sober, somber men. Let's have some peppier women in there, come on, and like that. That's the pagans. Of course, there are many sober women in religious institutions, and they are the ones that are setting the tone for sobriety for all the other women and all the other pagans there, saying, look, this is how you dress, this is how you act, this is how you sing, right? That's very important, because if you don't do that, the pagans will run riot, and they won't even come to church, really, because pagans are all mother worshipers, mother nature worshipers, and of course, mother is the symbol for the children of nature. So when you worship nature, you inherently put the mother figure at the center of your worship. It's matriarchal, mother worshiping, nature worshiping. So you certainly don't want to put that in charge of phase one, which is to tone down the whole nature worshiping thing. Now, if you're a riotous female who's a nature worshiper, and the world is full of those right now, and you truly repent, and all your sisters in nature worshiping are still wanting you to hang out with them, the last thing you want in church when you go is another pagan woman in charge saying, hey, it's okay, yeah. It's okay, you bring your friends here. Let's, you know, this is supposed to be a celebration of nature here. That's the last thing you want. What you want is some celibate, sober, toned down male authority figure saying, hey, we're toning all nature worship down here, okay? We're not gonna get rid of it all here yet, but we are severely toning it down. When you come to church, you're dressed soberly, your actions are sober, your actions are not, you know, as opposite of pagan. You are toning down your whole act here. That's what they want. That's exactly what they want. And that's what they should be able to get. Pagans should, those who repent should be able to get the right kind of help that they need, which is this sober authority figure that is not associated with nature worship. See, the men are not central to nature worship. It's always the woman, because the mother is what gives birth to the flesh. It's the mother that perpetuates nature. That's why I call it Mother Nature. That's why the church, Jesus picked 12 disciples as males, saying that if you want to help the pagans out, you have to have this sober authority figure presence and saying, we're toning it down here. No argument about it. Okay? It's very important. You can't have this intercessor. The whole thing about Mary being an intercessor of Jesus is nonsense. It's basically what the pagan's saying is, Jesus is too strict. Jesus is too strict. Please, Mary, Mother Nature, please intercede with Jesus and say, we can't take this strictness. Can you bring more paganism into the church? Please bring more paganism into the church. That's what it really is. That's not the true mother of Jesus, really. Mother Jesus, in my opinion, is most likely totally free of all nature, you know, being an adept herself, being part of that whole scene of Jesus. There were adepts there, you know, so I'm sure she has absolutely, totally free, totally used the complete absence of nature and enlightened. What they're worshiping is the mother goddess of the Egyptian, the fertility goddesses of matriarchal mother worshiping. That's who they're appealing to and saying, please, we need more paganism, we need more cowbell in here. Come on, get the cowbell in here. Jesus is too strict. Jesus is too strict. That's not good. That is not good. That is not good. But you have to start somewhere. And so there's some of that in Catholicism is, you know, you get these people who are complete pagans coming in. And they got to feel like, you know, where's my mother or goddess? Where is she? You know, what is this guy talking about up there, this priest? I don't understand this at all. But gradually it seeps into my, I see they don't understand really what's going on, the theory behind it at all. But the discipline, you sober, sobriety, you tone down your act every week. Actually, it's supposed to go every day, but at least once a week should be a requirement. You tone down your act every Sunday, you tone it down. So it's really important on Sundays, which in pagan society are dedicated to pagan revelry, actually. In a repentant society, in a repentant culture, Sunday is dedicated to no work, no play. You're going to church, you're toning down that day. That's the day you choose to get used to toning down your whole nature-worshipping act. It's absolutely essential. The idea of going to, some of these Catholics go, you know, once a year at Easter. That is nonsense. That's not true Catholicism. That is not at all. No way. They're missing the entire situation of it. It's practicing toning down your nation-worshipping act is what it's all about. And you sober up. You sober up. The people I notice, the young people in church are way more sober than the normal, than the other pagan people. Way more. They're, you know, still with their generation to some extent. But for one thing, you don't see any tattoos in church. It's amazing. When you go, when I go out and just look around in normal society, it seems like everyone I see, young people have conspicuous tattoos, and the older people are trying to be hip, you know, getting all these tattoos. This is sickening. The older people getting tattoos, you know, that's really sad. But you know, all this, which is a sign of pagan worship, tattoos actually. Solidarity with nature worship. In church, I don't see any tattoos. See, the attitudes of the young people there are toned down. They are toned down. Compared, you know, I wish they were a little more toned down, but you know, when you're young, you can't expect to be completely toned down. And there's a lot of women, young women dressed in very pagan ways there, very much so. That should be toned down. It's gotten way too lax. But in order to keep people coming in, they decided to relax the restrictions. There should be a dress code, actually, and there isn't. But the kids are toned down. The parents are toned down. No question about it. It's obvious. And you just talk, and then you go out back in the world and you say, wow. You go from there like to a restaurant. You go from church to a restaurant. And it's like, wow. You go into a restaurant. Wow, look at this. We go into a sports restaurant or something. Wow. The people are slobs. They're tattooed slobs. The kids run are like riotous. The way they express themselves, full of violence. I mean, I notice the children, the young people today, the undisciplined ones, the pagan ones, I see a kid there, and he's kind of by himself, and he's by his parents. He's acting out stuff, and he's going boom, boom, choo, ow, chop, chop. He's acting out the video games that he's pouring into his playing constantly, and they're like doing all these violent movements, like they're literally acting this stuff out. Yeah, and a friend of mine in Mexico telling me about how after school the children, what they do, they go play these video games constantly until they, you know, that's what they do. They don't even do their homework. And I said, what kind of video games? He says, the most violent possible. He said, I've never let my child watch those at all. They're absolutely the most violent games possible. Children in Mexico, that is what they're doing. They're not doing their homework. They're not going to church. They're spending all their free time possible playing constantly the most violent video games possible. And then we're surprised that these same young people end up being these notorious thugs in these drug cartel gangs, which is what they are. I mean, the older cartel members are terrified of the younger ones because they're completely crazy. They have no scruples whatsoever. They're just mayhem, you know, and the mayhem gets turned against the older members of the cartel. You know, it's that bad. And how's it happen? Of course, they're spending all their time saturated in these super violent video games. Now you contrast that with someone who spends their time going to church, and or someone who's very sober and very disciplined and doesn't allow that. The children are night and day difference. They're respective older people, because older people represent to them the discipline, the sobriety and discipline that they want to grow up in. You see, the culture they want to grow up in. So respecting authority is very important for younger people if they want to grow up in a very sober society, which will help tone their own nature, you know, nature worshiping tendencies down, so that they can get closer and closer and closer to the experiencing of the absence of nature, which doesn't mean the absence of beauty at all, just the opposite actually. Indeterminate, total pure indeterminance, which is total glory for all, omnipresent glory for all. All omnipresent glory for all. Every moment, omnipresent. Ceaselessly omnipresent. So, the pagan attitudes towards the world right now are extremely unhelpful for them. For them. It's not helping them at all. I'm being into phase four right now and getting ready for supernature, and maybe I am ready. It's more like I'm observing this world. I'm more like an observer here. So that's why I attend Catholic Church. I'm observing, you know, how does it work? Is it helpful? You know, and observing culture and everything about this world for future reference, because there's no choice. Pagans have no choice but to get into phase one. And then what I see is, well, the world's been overwhelmed. And the fact is that phase one, the churches around the world tried to keep out technology here. That's their goal, you see. Because they know, just like, let's say I left this world for supernature, and from supernature graduated to total acceptance of total indeterminacy, and then decided to, out of compassion, to come back into the world and help out, you know, help out everyone. Well, certainly, knowing, being able to experience this in this world, knowing what technology has done to this planet, which is to severely undermine the interest in phase one, okay, interest in all religion, and to amplify the nature worship to an unimaginable extent, to get into violence, and everything that technology has done actually is extraordinarily undermining, okay, of success here. So of course you would want to keep it out of a place. Absolutely. And in fact, what we're told is that, you know, in many places they keep out the wheel entirely. They keep out the wheel. Now, how they do that, I don't know. But they do. I mean, most ancient cultures didn't even have the wheel. You understand that? And I've heard some say that it severely retards the spiritual progress of a people to have the wheel. But ultimately, the most retarding force of all is technology, without question. So, of course, the Christian church tried to keep technology out of this planet, as did other churches, actually. They tried to keep advertising out. They tried to keep marketing. They tried to keep consumerism out. They tried to keep secular, humanistic materialism out of this planet so it couldn't take root here. And ultimately, they kept the dike there away, and the flood water didn't come in for a long time, and finally the dike broke and now the flood water came in. You also want to keep away from drugs, which are an essential part of nature worship. All these vices, pagan vices, you keep them out. Keep them out of the planet as much as possible. So, of course, and so in being an observer of what happened here on this planet, this is burned into me now, like, wow. There's no question that you have to take the hardest of hard lines on keeping science and technology out of the planet. No question about it. That does nobody any good, really. Not really. Now, what happened in this planet was what undermined religion more than anything was the Black Plague in Europe and the inability of the church to protect parishioners from it, you see, and many think that the Black Plague was actually a bioterrorism by extraterrestrials meddling in this planet, trying to intentionally undermine the church, the authority of this planet. So what happened was people turned against the church, and then they turned towards science and technology, because science says, hey, we can figure out, you know, how to stop this, right? So I would say that biotechnology from extraterrestrials, interlopers here, they know how to infect various animals with these organisms that they have genetically engineered, and create massive pandemics on the planet, which then completely undermine the authority of those on this planet, you see. So certainly, we would have a keen eye to that, you know, preventing that. Certainly preventing extraterrestrials from visiting the planet, if that's possible, you know, keep them out. Quarantine the planet so they cannot be meddled with like this. So these are the lessons of history. I mean, being here, you learn the lessons of history. And some say, of course, that AIDS is genetically engineered. They say it's a human made. It's probably extraterrestrial made. But keep in mind, the extraterrestrials have been here for quite some time. A lot of them underground, working with Earth scientists, actually sharing information through careful means. Some say that Steve Jobs actually was given a lot of extraterrestrial technology to develop the whole Apple empire, actually. That's just one example. So Ebola could also be a genetically engineered pandemic. It could very well be that they are manufacturing pandemics right now in their laboratories, secret laboratories, to collapse the authoritative structure in this world, to collapse religion altogether, and make people who believe in prayer and all that seem to be complete idiots. And to inoculate everybody. I mean, the whole mania of inoculation right now is just unbelievably insane. We brought our cat to be inoculated with stuff I didn't, someone else did. And they got shot after shot after shot. And the poor cat was so completely sick. And the cat's freaked out now. It's like gone back to being feral. You know, it don't let anyone get near it from these inoculations. My dad wouldn't let me get inoculations. I don't know if I've ever even had any. I'm not sure. I won't get flu shots. I don't get any shots. Yeah, that is seen now as the great crime, is a refusal to be inoculated is the great crime. Of course, what they'll do is introduce nanotechnology into all these inoculations. And these inoculations tend to create great differences in your behavior and your all this stuff. I mean, just look at the cat, how drastically it was affected by those shots that it got. Tends to turn you away from where you need to be. So of course these pandemics create mass hysteria in the world, and they then undermine undermine religious authority. There's no question about it, and they raise the status of science and technology vastly, raised, because they say, oh, don't worry, we'll have a vaccination for that one of these days. Don't worry, we have the answer for you. Where actually the answer really is prayer. This is profoundly undermining of religion, especially phase one religious people who are, you know, still largely nature worshipers. And so we have this, you know, pandemic going now, which I'm paying no attention to. I have no idea what's going on with it, but I get the writing on the wall. I understand what the whole purpose of this is to bring about this collapse in the belief in religion, spiritual truth, all this, undermine and make people worship science and technology, which is really worshiping nature, which is really worshiping determinancy. See, the real, as Jesus said, the perfect defense against everything is indeterminacy. Nothing can touch you. Jesus could not be touched while he was here by any harm whatsoever, because he knew he's manifesting his own experience. Moment by moment by moment, totally indeterminate. It's so indeterminate, he said, you can kill me and I'll raise the body in 3 days. Actually, he could have raised it instantly, but they would have claimed he's not dead then. So he said, okay, I'll let the body stay in the grave for you. You want that? All right, no problem. Just like he left Lazarus in the grave for a while before he came. He says, all right, rise up, Lazarus. There's no such thing as determinacy. You know that. And Lazarus said, yeah, I know. And so his body was in the grave for a little while. Not that long. Friday afternoon till Sunday morning. That's not that long. See, 24, 12, 34, maybe 36 hours, maybe 33 hours. I don't know how long he's actually in the grave, but not that long. But long enough so the pagans said he's dead. You know, they pierced his side with the sword. Said, okay, body's definitely dead. By standards of nature, this body is dead, no question. And then appeared completely alive, knowing that reality's totally indeterminate. Totally natural for him, you see. No effort required. So, same thing with sickness. You don't have to get sick. Sickness is of nature, the belief in nature. The less you believe in nature, the less you'll get sick. Right. Now, one thing I found helpful is people, pagans, have to worship like a goddess, basically. They do, whether they think they are or not, they are. For them, you need to have a figure that represents a goddess, but a goddess without, absent of nature, like Virgin Mary, for instance. Okay. This is a goddess figure, so you feel comfortable, and pagans feel comfortable with the mother figure. But this is a mother figure that is absent of all nature. Virginal, immaculate, untouched by nature. Turn any sickness you have over to her and say, oh, okay, maybe I'll experience this later. Okay, say, I don't want to experience this now, but maybe I'll experience this later. So can you hold this for me? And she'll say, sure, no problem. Now, I've done this many times and it works, actually. But you can also turn your sickness over to Jesus. Okay, this is more difficult for pagans, actually, because when it gets down, when you're really sick, you turn to the mother. What does the child do when the child is really sick with a fever, you know, measles, mumps, chicken pox, flu, infected tooth, all sorts of, the children get all sorts of illnesses, right? Who do they go to? They go to mommy. They go to mommy. There's no question about it. 100%. Daddy's there, but no, it's mommy, 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 mommy. So the problem is when you fall ill, you fall back into turning to the mother. Okay, this is true. So that's why the immaculate goddess figure that is absent of all nature is helpful and necessary. Because you don't really trust the dad at that point, so to speak. You say, no, I want mommy, I'm really sick. Because you're used to feeling, when you feel helpless and hopeless and weak, like a little child, it's the mother who's feeding you, taking care of you, doing everything for you. So when you get really sick, you say, where's my mom? Yeah, where's my mom? But what you need, okay, hear me well on this, is a mother who, the Immaculate Mother, who's free, absent, total absence of nature, even though there's still an appearance of form there. Okay, the formless form. And to give her the illness, say, you know what? I don't have any time for this right now. I'm on a spiritual path. Jesus is calling me. So, here, can I give you this illness and will you keep it for me? Because I know you can't get sick because you have the total absence of nature. Nothing can touch you. So you take this illness for me and hold on to it for me. And if I want to experience it at some time later, then I know you'll give it back to me. I know you will. You know. So you just give this nature syndrome, which you call sickness, to the Immaculate Virgin. You say, here, Mom, you hold on to this for me for a while. And the illness will disappear. I've done this many times, and it disappears. You say, I have no time for this. I have no interest in this. I have no time for this. I don't need this. And yet, I know the whole world is saying, you need this, you need this, you need to get sick. I say, okay, I'll tell you what. Do not try to oppose it and say, I'm never going to have this. You will cave in. It doesn't work. Because that's only someone who's already enlightened can do that. So take it and give it to her, the mother figure. The goddess that is completely free of all, absence of all nature. And say, not now. I don't want it now. Maybe later. I don't want it now, but maybe later. This is the key technique for a lot of troubles in this world. I don't want this now, but maybe later. Maybe you can use this for destitution too. I may have to try and practice this right now. Heading into a bad situation, I may say, you know what? This whole idea of destitution really turns you into like a mother nature's son. It's like you just, you know, be out in nature all the time. And stuff. You know what? I say, I don't have time for that because I need to keep the body feeling, you know, very comfortable in terms of being able to practice like this. I cannot be starving and desperate for shelter in this world. So maybe I'll experience this later. Not right now. Don't have time for it now. So let me give you this destitution, okay? And you hold on to that for me. And you know that it's, you reach some point, you say, you know, I don't never need that at all. Then she'll say, okay, vanish, gone. See? But she won't vanish it without you telling her to do so. All right, she'll hold on to it for you. So I say, yeah, just take all, and it's the same thing with Jesus. You say, take all my sins. It's the exact same thing. Here, Jesus, let me give you all of these problems of nature. I don't really need them right now. I don't want them right now. You take them. And I know that you'll hold on to them for me until later, if I need them. If I need them. That's the whole thing. Give all your sins to Jesus. Give all your troubles to Jesus. Give all your... Well, it works. It actually works. It actually works. The problem is most people, again, when they have severe troubles, they always turn to their mom. So it may be better to give it to this immaculate female figure, the mother figure, who's devoid of all nature. And you can easier give it all to that. You know, that's what I've experienced. Jesus is more like the authority figure that is teaching us and pulling us to supernature. so we maybe people don't really give all of it to Jesus. You know, they hold on to some of it. Because like when we're in big trouble, we always go to our mom. That's a universal fact here for almost everybody. So the church is probably very wise having Jesus and also Mary there. But in no way should Mary be a subject of veneration. Okay? In no way. That is not appropriate. Because then that's trying to turn her into a nature goddess. So basically, what you're afraid to give to Jesus, you give to Mary, so to speak, is what they say. Because we think Jesus may try to evaporate it and say, no, I don't want you to ever have this. And we say, no, I might want it later. I might want it later. It's like when you take a toy away from a kid, or you say, it's the mother who can get it from. So she'll say, don't worry, I'll give it back to you later. You know, oh, don't eat that here. If you, and the kid says, no, I'm crying. She says, well, I'll tell you what, I'll put it aside right here. And if you want it later, I'll give it back to you, okay? And just okay. It's like that. This is basic psychology of the situation here. So a lot of people are afraid to give to Jesus because they feel Jesus is going to take it and say, no, you can't have it anymore. I'm going to get rid of it for you. And then we say, no. I don't want that. I might want it later. So I've found the central technique of not now, maybe later. Not now, maybe later. Not now, maybe later. Don't say no, unequivocally no, to all the pagan stuff, nature stuff. Just say, hey, nature, you know, not right now, maybe later. So this should open up enlightenment for us. It should open up something, the door for us right now. If we can just say, you know, nature, I don't need to see you at all right now. I can just see the enlightened form of the absence of nature. I don't want to see you right now, but maybe later. Maybe later. I give all this to Jesus and they call the Blessed Mother. I give all this to either one or both, and they'll keep it for me. You know, Jesus will keep it for me. Just I don't need to see it right now. I don't need to be experiencing it right now. I don't need to be experiencing this fatigue, this age, this sense of infirmity. But do not say I'm trying to get rid of it all forever. This will stick you with it. You'll be stuck with it. It doesn't work. I've tried. It doesn't work. The continuity fear is too severe. So, the cat walking by. Say not now, maybe later. Okay. I don't need this feeling of fatigue, of stress. I don't need it at all. But maybe later. Maybe later. Say maybe later. Maybe later, maybe later, maybe later. Now, of course, when quote unquote later, faced with the same choice, you'll say, well, you know, not now. I really don't, no, I don't feel like it now, but maybe later, maybe later. You can do that with death, actually. You can say, death, I don't feel like dying right now, maybe later, maybe later. Poverty, I assume you can do it. I don't really feel like being poor right now, but maybe later. Don't close the door because, you see, reality is indeterminate. When you say never, you're being determinate. This is the trap. This is the trap. So never say no to suffering. Say maybe later. This centers you in your spiritual nature. Ultimately, you'll realize that all is totally indeterminate, and there's no point in playing with determinacy at all. You see? but if you say, no, I'm never going to do that, you lock yourself. If you say, I'm never going to be sick, I'm never going to get cancer, for instance, it's impossible for me to get cancer, I can never get cancer, that's not true. You're locking yourself into determinacy then by saying, never, I can never. In this way, this is an experience, okay? You cannot say that you can never experience something because that means you're not free to experience it. You're free to experience cancer if you want, at any moment you want to, if that's what you want to do. If you want to have a body that's experiencing cancer and then in spirit is experiencing a situation, fine. It's absolutely free to do so. You can also be absolutely free not to do so. So in your freedom, say, well, you know, I really don't feel like experiencing that right now, but maybe later. You're not rejecting anyone's experiencing in this world. You're saying you do have the option of maybe later. And ultimately, you do have the option of not even dreaming this dream. Of course, you can dream it later if you want. See? You can. If we want to, we can go back into this nightmare if we want to. God doesn't prohibit it. As Jesus says in His infinite wisdom, we are all perfectly free, and you are free to continue this dream as long as you want. And God, and He says, does God get angry for this? He says, absolutely not. God is not in the slightest bit angry with us in any way, shape, or form. Not disappointed with us. Full love, always. And if we want to continue with this dream of determinacy, we are absolutely free to do so. This is true teaching. This is true teaching. So, don't say never. You might say never, which is the right use of never. Maybe you say, I'll never be born again. Well, say, you know, I'm not going to be born again right now. I mean, turns out I have another birth. No, I'm not going to have another birth now, but maybe later. Maybe later, yeah. But so we get tricked in this world by determinacy to be absolutely opposed to determinacy, saying never. And that makes us determinate, doesn't it? It's a trap here. It's a big, big trap. That's why Longchenpa says hanging loosely, relaxed in the spontaneity of the now. You're not saying this or that and this. Don't get trapped into determinacy. And I certainly have, we all do. It's interesting, the very things that I say, I'm never gonna do that. That's the one thing I never wanna do. I'm now trapped in it. Wow, very interesting. So paradoxically, the way to get free of all this birth and death is not to be free of it, but to say that you're open to it happening again and again and again and again, if that's what you desire. You're perfectly free to do so if you want to. It's just right now, you don't want to. That's fine. So I have found that whatever I oppose the most, that's the situation I end up in. So the key would be to say, yeah, this could be another experiencing at some moment. Absolutely, everything could be an experiencing. I just, right now, I'm not going to do it, but maybe later. And so don't get into a defensive, oppositional state, determinate state of mind. Which is why I say full stop in the now when you're listening. Don't struggle. When I say don't struggle, it means don't be pro or con, for or against. Don't get into this never mode. Just abide in what is right here, right now. Very tricky here, because when we say no, I don't ever want to experience that, and I won't feel free if I experience that, then the ego pushes us into experience that. Say, no, here I'm helping you with your freedom, because this is, but we still don't want to experience it. But you trap yourself. Lazy man's guide to alignment says, love everything just the way it is. Whatever you're experiencing, just tell yourself that you have chosen this. but it's a little different than that. It's you've tricked yourself into choosing it, thinking that this is preventing your freedom, so that you need to like this experience. That's not true. You don't need to like cancer to at least say, you know what, maybe someday, maybe I'll experience that at some point, but maybe not. Not right now, maybe later. That doesn't mean you want to or like it or anything, but you don't oppose the freedom, your own freedom to experience it if you want to. You're not against the reality that we're perfectly free. So we need to clarify this a little bit more, really, in pragmatic ways. In other words, you don't leave this world by saying, I'm never coming back here. No, you say, you know, right now I don't want to be here, but maybe later I will. I'm not saying never to it. So if you can, right where you are, just say to everything where you are, just maybe, eliminate the never entirely. Of course, that's difficult to do because it's likely you're in the very situations that you hate the most, where you say never, you know, I never want to experience this, and that's where you're stuck. So you're like, no, I want to oppose this, I hate this. Well, you have to acknowledge your freedom. And freedom means you're free to experience anything whatsoever. So you cannot say that you're not free to experience this. What these experiences are really trying to do is trying to get you to the point of never. So you're not free. So you put yourself, the ego puts you in, or you put yourself in the attempt to separate from God in situations that you hate. You don't want to be there. And then you try to get into this never mode, like I'm never going to do this again. And then you essentially have you have an attitude which is separate from reality, right? From freedom. And of course we say, well, God made all this and we're put in this terrible situation. I never want to be here. You're saying you never want to be in God's creation is what you're saying, but God did not, this is not all creation of God. This is a expression of our own imagination. And we put ourselves in terrible situations. So we can say, I never want to do this again. And I never will. And then see, never will means I'm not free. I am not free, and therefore no one else is free either. So one has to, the only thing about Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment and all these teachings is they need to be streamlined a little bit because you need to give freedom to everybody. You see, not just yourself. That's not the point. You have to extend your freedom to everyone. In other words, everyone is free to be totally stuck exactly where they are. Extend that freedom, and then you are no longer stuck at all. See, you cannot say, oh, you have cancer. No, I hate that. I don't want you to have that at all. You should never have gotten that. Never, you know. You have to say you're absolutely free to have cancer. Totally free. And also totally free not to. And your having cancer doesn't affect me in the slightest bit. Doesn't affect the indeterminate freedom that is in the slightest bit. One moment. Okay, we'll get into this a little more later. All right, that's it.